Hello and welcome to a new first part of this series. In this part, as the headline indicates, I'll talk about that little question, what is magic? Well, first of all, I have to point out that the word magic is used in three very different ways. There is, on the one hand, stage magic, as David Copperfield, that freak Chris Angel, and Penn and Teller, and so on. All those guys are doing stage magic. What I like about Penn and Teller, by the way, is they explain it. What I don't like about others, and well, Penn and Teller dislike that too, is when someone stands on the stage and really claims to have supernatural powers. Stage magic, unfortunately, is in some parts of the world, for example India, used by people that really claim to have supernatural powers, and people fall for that. And not only in the third world. I know of a guy who really fell for a very, very cheap trick. The same trick that you can see in the end of the movie The Man in the Moon. The Man in the Moon? That movie about Andy Kaufman, you know. It's a very cheap trick, but people fall for it. The second way the word magic is used is, let's call it fantasy magic. Magic that we can find in fantasy books, but also in religious texts, where some claims of miracles and supernatural stuff are made. Fantasy magic always appeals to our desires and fantasies and wishes for how we want the world to be. And as I said, quite often stage magic is used with exactly that appeal to our wishes and hopes and fantasies. And the third way that we can or we should use the word magic, let's call it historic magic, because there's a tradition of literature where people wrote about what they call magic, and some of the stuff they wrote about is quite useful, not in a supernatural way, but in other ways. For example, we all know that Newton was an astrologer, and modern chemistry has its roots in alchemy. These examples show that historic magic has its use, and that there is still something to be discovered in those old books. Another example would be the work of Sigmund Freud. Freud used old Greek mythology to create his form of psychology. And, well, that shows how we can use that school of literature, that tradition of literature, to find out how we can use or how we can make conscious certain aspects of ourselves, and thereby of the world we are living in. Now there is one thing that I have to point out. When you look at some books like lexica, encyclopedias and so on, and you read where the word magic comes from, most of them cheat when they say that magic, the word magic, comes from Old Greek, and it means something like fraud, make-believe, and so on. Charlatanery, probably wrong pronunciation, I don't care. That's wrong. The word magic doesn't come from Old Greek, it comes from Old Persian. And there's one person that was called or referred to as a magician. And I think that most people know about that person. At least most people heard that name. His name was Zardesh, or Zarathustra, or Zoroaster. The old Persian empire was very large. It reached from India to, or from some parts of what's now India, to what's now Iran. And at a certain point in history, that empire broke apart. And Zarathustra prevented the remaining parts of that empire from further falling apart by inventing a new religion. And I'm not sure if this is right, but at least it's interesting. I heard somewhere that there was a tribe in the Persian Empire called the Magus. And these Magus had the privilege of being priests. And by that you see that the word magician basically means priests. Magicians are priests. Now, the gods that priests preach about are basically symbols. They're symbols of abilities, of desires, and of things that we want to be, or that we want to happen. And gods, also angels and all the other kind of supernatural beings, are not only symbols for certain abilities that we have, even if that having of those abilities is just potentially, so we are having that ability, but we are not using it. Maybe we even refuse to use it, consciously or not. Gods and angels and so on are also figures of authority. And by talking for those beings, a magician becomes during a ritual, be it a magical ritual somewhere in a cave, or be it a magical ritual in a church where the priest, the magician, is standing in front of the people and preaching about something. The magician becomes the spokesperson for that figure of authority, and so he becomes, or she becomes, the figure of authority. Now, for me personally, my, so to speak, journey into magic started when someone told me that the believer believes to be created by God or the gods, and the magician understands that he creates God or the gods. So we create these symbols. And these symbols are quite useful because they are anthropomorphized. We create these symbols as if they are beings. We create these beings as symbols. And since we don't think of them as symbols, but as beings, we can work with them in a completely different way, in a very useful way. We can ask them for something and maybe it happens. Christians call that prayer. In rituals, that's quite often connected to offerings and stuff like that, or to ordeals. And that shows that these kinds of symbols can be used in a completely different way. Now, my personal definition of magic hasn't changed. It is still, and allow me to think about how I express it in English, magic is the method of using numinous powers to work by the magician's will. Numinous powers, of course, is an abstract expression that means gods, angels, the force, or whatever. However you want to think of those potential abilities you have, of those desires you have, and so on. Let's just call them numinous powers when you want to work with that definition. Well, one more thing, and I forgot to say that in the German version. As I just said, we create gods. We have the ability to create gods. Now, a theist, a believer, is not conscious of that, and most of the time they do not want to face the fact that they create their gods, or God. They don't want that. They want to give the authority over themselves to something that they created, but they do not want to face the fact that they created that figure of authority. But, well, it's a sad story. Now, atheists, they know that they create gods, that humans have the ability to create gods, but they do not want to use it because they see the abuse of that power. And to me, that's the point where what I call a magician and atheists differ. A magician knows that he creates gods, and he uses that ability. An atheist knows that humans have the ability to create gods, but he don't want to use that ability. And since magic is connected to fantasy, always. That's like saying, I don't want to have fantasy. It's a sad world, but I don't want to paint pictures of atheists being bad because I like atheists, and I think the atheist movement is something very important at the moment. Well, to conclude this little video, I want to give you a little example of how these numinous symbols, how numinous powers, how gods can be used to make potential abilities available. When I went to school, I really sucked at math. I nearly failed to finish school because of math. It was the mercy of my math teacher that he said, "All right, you suck at math, but I let you pass. I don't want to hinder you." And I'm still thankful to that guy. Now, when I was done with school, while starting to get into magic, I did some workings with beings like Hermes, Mercury, the Egyptian Thoth or Tot, let's just call him Duty, that's the Egyptian way to pronounce that name. And that god is connected to mathematics, so by working with these beings, I discovered that mathematics is beautiful, and now I'm loving mathematics to an extent that I subscribe to the channel Numberphile, and I love those videos. Mathematics now to me is something like poetry. Some people asked me to do a video about the pentagram, and I'm afraid I will not be able to resist to talk about the mathematical properties of the golden ratio and the pentagram in that video. I'll try to make it short because I know that most people hate mathematics. But from my point of view, those people that hate mathematics block themselves. They have the ability, they just do not want to use that ability. Sometimes because they believe that being bad, sucking at math, is part of who they are. From my perspective, that's not true. So, to conclude this video, I urge you to leave comments where I expressed things in a way that cannot be understood because I was rushing through my short notes here. And when you leave those comments, you give me reason to do videos about exactly those aspects that I expressed in a not so good way. And yeah, you keep me going. So that's it for this time. Enjoy yourselves, enjoy your life, enjoy everything there is. Have a good time and see you soon.